Thank you very much. Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So I don't have any Olympic credentials. I can't guarantee I'm going to bring you all to tears like Catherine Granger apparently did earlier. But I do know that I'm the final speaker of this conference. And so think of me as, you know, when you those of you who go to a gym, when you have a really hard workout, I'm the warming down session on the treadmill. You know, so, you know, you've had your mind stretched, you've been thinking hard, you've been working hard. I'm going to stretch your minds, but more of a sort of a limbering up sort of stretching that hopefully will be fun. What I want to talk about, and actually fits in very nicely with the theme for the conference, the shock of the new, I want to talk about a new area of science and how shockingly and exciting it is that it's coming together, different disciplines, to answer some fundamental questions. But I'm going to begin by posing it in terms of how we uncover new ideas in science, how we make discoveries, how we learn about the universe and our place in it. And we often tend to do that in terms of posing puzzles, conundrums, paradoxes. So I'll start with talking about the sorts of paradoxes that aren't really paradoxes because we've figured out the answer. But it's quite fun because it gives me a chance to throw some brain teasers in your direction. Now, this is a famous quote, I think it was Albert Einstein, I'm pretty sure it is, but he said, the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it is comprehensible. We have no right to think that we will be able to make sense of the complexity of the world around us, and yet science seems to be able to do that. And what's great is that science hasn't got all the answers yet, otherwise we'd all pack up and go home. There are still big, fundamental questions that we don't have an answer to. But can science provide all the answers? You know, just how far can we push the scientific method? And you know, many people from the arts or who have religious faith or philosophers will say, well, science is just one way of looking at the world. But for me as a scientist, the scientific method, the idea of gathering evidence, empirically testing hypotheses, and if your theory doesn't fit the way the world works, then you have to ditch it and come up with a different theory and hypothesis. That the scientific method does give us a way of, you know, I believe there's an objective reality out there, a truth that we're trying to reach, and I think science is the way that allows us to learn about that truth, about the universe. But it does, as I say, lead to certain counterintuitive ideas that in the beginning present themselves as paradoxes. So I love, this is a picture, this is on the front cover of a book that I wrote, but that's on the American edition, and I really like that cover. So this is Schrodinger's cat inside an Escher cube, just to mess with your minds a bit. So you can see paradoxically, I mean, obviously Schrodinger's cat paradox, you're not supposed to see inside the box, because this is the cat that's dead and alive at the same time. So obviously a transparent cube, you know, renders it all a bit pointless, but anyway, it's a nice picture. So what I wanted to do was really start to talk about paradoxes. There's the paradox of Schrodinger's cat. I'm not going to go into that paradox of the grandfather paradox of time travel. But I want to start with, you know, what do we mean by a paradox? Here's a nice, simple statement. This statement is a lie. But of course, if it's lying about being a lie, then it's not a lie, it's the truth. And if it's true, then this statement really is a lie. Therefore, it's a lie, and so on. That is a true logical paradox, and I'm not interested in those sorts of paradoxes, because it just goes around in a circle and it gets you nowhere. It's a bit boring. The nice paradoxes are the ones that are the puzzles where there is an answer to them. And there are two types of such paradoxes. So there's something called a veridical paradox. So this is something that seems like an absurdity, but nevertheless, it's true because, you know, you can work through the logic and you can figure out actually, if you think about it in the right way, then it turns out that it is true. And I'll give you a quick example of this. It's a very nice brain teaser told to me by a colleague of mine, a Scottish professor of physics. And he said this: every Scotsman who travels south of the border to England raises the average IQ of both nations. And, you know, yes, if they think about it for a while, of course, surely that's paradoxical, that can't be true. But of course, it is, because as far as, obviously this is from a Scottish perspective, not an English one. you know, since the Scots are on average or more intelligent than the English, then any Scotsman who leaves Scotland will be cleverer than all the English, and he raises the IQ of England, the average IQ. But he must be a really stupid Scotsman to want to leave Scotland in the first place, leaving behind a more intelligent Scottish nation. So that's an example of a veridical paradox. It sounds paradoxical, think about it, actually it's not. And a lot of the paradoxes that we set up in science are of this type, that they sound paradoxical until you learn the science behind it. You learn an explanation, you have a deeper understanding about the laws of nature, and you realize the paradox just dissolves away. The other type is called a falsidical paradox. So, again, sounds like an absurdity, but you know it can't be true. And the more you think about it, you think, where am I going wrong? And let me give you an example of this. And I want to leave a few minutes at the end for Q&A, so you might want to ask me the answers, because I'm not going to give you the answer. I'm going to throw it at you, let you stew on it for a while. Not too much, because you have to concentrate on the other stuff I'm going to be talking about. And we'll come back to it later. So here's my favorite falsidical paradox. And it's called the puzzle of the missing dollar. And again, I think, you know, you're a bright audience, so I suspect there's a number of you who have heard this before, but keep it to yourselves. There'll be a number of you who will figure out the answer straight away. Keep it to yourselves. But I still guarantee the majority probably won't. Will be rather disturbed. The story goes like this. Three friends check into a hotel, and they have one. They're sharing a room between them, and it costs $30. So they each pay $10 at the reception, pay up front, get their key, and go up to their room. In the meantime, the guy behind the desk realizes that there is a special offer on that week, and he should have only charged them $25. So he takes $5 bills from the till and rushes up to their room to apologize and give them the money back. On the way there, he realizes he can't split $5 three ways. So he says, I know what, I'll give them $3 back, one each, and I'll pocket the other two. Everyone's a winner. And that's what he does. So here's the problem. They've now each paid $9. Three nines are 27, plus the two in his pocket makes 29. Where's the missing dollar? Yeah, you're not laughing now, are you? Right, it's simple arithmetic, right? What's going wrong? Okay, I'll leave that with you. I guess some of you will have heard it, and some of you will have figured it out. But we'll come back to it later. But I want to focus on a few paradoxes in science that are fun. In fact, the first one is a paradox of maths. And again, I think some of you will have seen it, heard it before. Can I have a show of hands? How many people have heard of the game show paradox, the three doors with the prize behind one of them? Okay, so probably about a dozen of you, which is not bad. Good. So the Monty Hall paradox is, Monty Hall was the Canadian-born American game show host. He hosted this long-running show in America, Let's Make a Deal, on which Noel Edmonds' Deal or No Deal was based, and is even more stupid. And the idea is that he invites the audience to guess where a prize is. And it first came to light in the 70s. A statistician at Berkeley called Steve Selvin published a short paper in a mathematical journal in which he described this particular paradox. And it led to sort of some discussion, as simply put. But it didn't really hit the headlines, the wider world, until the early 90s, when it was published in Parade magazine in America. And in particular, in the column by Marilyn Vos Savant. Now, Marilyn Vos Savant, I don't know if you've heard of her, in the 80s, she was in the Guinness Book of Records for having the world's highest IQ. It's very silly what that means, but anyway, she's a very bright woman. Presumably she could have done anything with her life, but what she was doing was she wrote this agony aunt type column in this weekly magazine where she would give advice, answer problems, you know, all sorts of things. You could throw anything at her. And a reader wrote in about the Monty Hall paradox, and I haven't told you what it is yet. And he said, you know, I don't get it. This is a paradox, this is a brain teaser. What's the solution? She published in the next edition the answer, and she was right. But it led to this huge uproar from other readers writing in saying that she couldn't be right. She didn't know what she was talking about. I'm going to show you just a few examples of some of the responses that she got. As a professional mathematician, I'm very concerned with the general public's lack of mathematical skills. Please help by confessing your error and in the future being more careful. Well, that's sort of reasonably polite. You blew it and you blew it big. You seem to have difficulty grasping the basic principle at work here. There's enough mathematical illiteracy in this country and we don't need the world's highest IQ propagating more. Shame. Two or three more. May I suggest that you obtain and refer to a standard textbook on probability before you try to answer a question of this type again? I'm in shock that after being corrected by at least three mathematicians, you still don't see your mistake. And here's my favorite. Maybe women look at math problems differently to men. These are people with PhDs in maths, and they're writing in. And, you know, they ended up with egg on their faces because she was right. But it had to be explained. It just goes to show the subtlety of this puzzle. So I should get on with it and tell you what it is. The game show is this. There are three doors, and there's a prize behind one of the doors. Behind the other two doors, the prize is a car or something. And behind the other two doors, this is the form it was originally written in, weren't prizes, they were just goats. I don't know why goats. But the assumption is the contestant isn't a goat-loving cyclist and actually would want to win the car. So you have a one-in-three chance. I'm the game show host. You're the contestant. Let's say you pick one of the doors. You pick door A. You have a one-in-three chance of being right. As the game show host, I know where the prize is. I'm going to help you out. I'm going to open door B, revealing a goat. And I say, right, now, do you want to stick with A, or do you want to switch to C? Of those of you who don't, which is the majority of you who haven't seen this before, how many would stick to A? Show of hands. And how many would switch to C? Good, roughly 50-50. One in two chance, right? So those who want to switch to C, ooh, interesting, he's giving me a lifeline. Is there something in it? I'll switch to C. Those who are sticking to A going, you're not catching me out, mate. No, I've made my choice. I'm going to stick with it. Well, hit the paradox, in the sense that it's counterintuitive, is that you should always switch to C. You double your chances of winning if you switch to C. If you stick with A, the chances of the car being behind door A is a 1 in 3 chance, not 1 in 2, and the chance of it being behind C is 2 in 3. So the paradox is that it doesn't seem to make sense. And yet this is a veridical paradox in as much as it's correct, and there's a simple explanation for it. So, show of hands, how many people are surprised by that? There you go, good. Okay, there are several ways of explaining this. The nicest one that I know of was actually explained to me by the comedian Dara O'Brien. Now, Dara O'Brien has a degree in theoretical physics, So he's, you know, smart guy. And he says I don't know where he'd read this particular solution, but he said this is the one that made most sense. Imagine there weren't just three doors, there were 1,000 doors. You choose door number one. You have a 1 in 1,000 chance that the prize is there. Remember, the crucial thing is that I know where the prize is. I then proceed to open doors 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, all goats, 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 goats. I leave door 566 closed, door 567, 68, all the way to door 1,000. 998 goats I reveal to you. I've left your door number one closed and door 566. Will you switch? There's something special, right? Exactly the same logic applies when there's three doors. And the crucial thing, as I say, is I know where the prize is. You see, it would be one in two if I didn't know. But then one in three times we play the game, I would open the door with the car behind it. Whoops. You know, and that's ruined the game. You've chosen door A, one in three chance. There's a two in three chances behind B or C. If it's behind C, I'll open door B. If it's behind B, I would have opened door C. So that two in three chance gets transferred entirely to the door that I've left closed because I've opened and removed the redundant door that I know doesn't have the prize behind it. Okay, so that's an example of a paradox, something that seems like a paradox until you explain it away. And even when it's explained, you think, yeah, but it's still weird. I'm still not sure about it. You can do it if you get three cards, say, you know, two black and one red card, and play it again with a partner and let them choose one of the cards, and you know where the red one is and you reveal the other black one. Statistically, you will see that actually it is. It's one in three, two in three. So you can do by trial and error in that way. I want to move on to talk a little bit about some physics paradoxes, because that leads on to some of these big profound questions that we're now starting to address. Not this one. This one in particular, I like this paradox because it's my favorite of all paradoxes in science, because it's so simple and yet not that well known. Olber's paradox asks a very basic question. Why does it get dark at night? Okay, because the sun goes down and, you know, and the reflected light from the moon and planets and distant stars isn't enough to illuminate the night sky. But it's deeper than that, because, so what I've got here is a picture of a forest. Imagine this were an infinite forest, trees going on forever. And you stand in this forest and you fire an arrow. You shoot an arrow from a bow, and we have to ignore gravity. We'll have to assume that arrow keeps going horizontally until it hits a tree trunk. Now, you can very carefully try and avoid all trees in, you know, nearby. But if it's an infinite forest, there's no way that arrow won't hit a tree trunk eventually. And even if you cut down 90% of the trees in the forest, all that happens is that on average that arrow will travel 10 times further before it hits a tree trunk. So there's a tree in any direction you care to fire the arrow. This puzzle, and I'll say a little bit about history in a moment, but it reverses this scenario. It says, when you look up into the night sky, if the universe were infinite, if there were stars spreading out to infinity, then surely in every direction you care to look, ultimately there will always be a star in your line of sight. So why isn't the night sky completely full of stars? In fact, why is the night sky dark at all? Why isn't it blazingly bright as the surface of the sun? So, you know, night and day will be equally bright and much brighter than the day we have now, only illuminated by the sun. And, you know, and I'll say a little bit about the history, but, you know, for example, we know that stars don't go out, spread out evenly in space to infinity. We know that stars are clumped together in galaxies. But the same issue holds. Why isn't there a galaxy in every line of sight that we look? And so it won't be quite as bright as a star, but still blazingly, you know, extremely bright. The paradox itself goes all the way back to the birth of modern science. Nicholas Copernicus was the person, I mean, he essentially, the great breakthrough of Copernicus was to say that we on Earth are not special, because the Earth isn't at the center of the universe. The Earth is just another planet orbiting around the sun, not the other way around. The heliocentric model of the universe, not the geocentric model. This wonderful picture from his book, De Revolutionibus, in which he shows Sol, the sun in the middle, and there's Earth Terra orbiting around. It's one of those iconic images in science that really changed the way we understand the universe. But what Copernicus didn't do was explain the whole universe. He was explaining just the solar system, because he still had, you see that outer circle, stellarum fixarum, the orbit of the fixed stars. He believed the stars also orbited the sun. He didn't know that the sun was just another star, nothing really very special. The big breakthrough there came from a rather unsung hero of science, and his name was Thomas Diggs. He was an amateur astronomer, English astronomer, who was one of the first people to translate Copernicus's work from Latin into English. And in the translation, he added notes of his own. And what he said was, those stars need not be fixed in an orbit around the sun. What if those stars are set free and scattered out into infinite space? That, which we know is true, is correct, although we know he didn't know about galaxies and so on. But that is correct. So our solar system is just one little region of the whole cosmos. And that leads to this idea, what's called Olbers' paradox. Now, Olbers was a 19th century German astronomer that historically it's been named after him, but it goes back to people like Thomas Diggs. Thomas Diggs said, but if the universe is infinite, full of stars, then surely there should be a star everywhere I look. So why does it get dark at night? A number of other astronomers came after him, tried to figure it out. So Kepler, in the 17th century, said, well, the reason is because the universe isn't infinite. It doesn't go on forever. What you see is all there is. Edmund Halley, English astronomer in the 18th century, said, no, the universe can go on forever. It's just that, you know, logic, the distant stars are too dim to light up the night sky. The further away they are, the dimmer they are, and therefore they're going to contribute less and less to the overall luminosity of the sky. But astronomers did very simple calculations to show that actually, if you sort of hold a coin up against the night sky, blocking out a particular region, that it may block out two or three nearby stars. They're nearer, therefore they're brighter. But that would also block out a larger area or volume of space further away, which will contain more stars. And if you do the maths, the larger number of more distant and dimmer stars produces collectively exactly the same luminosity as the smaller number of nearer and therefore brighter stars. So the idea that the dimmer ones don't contribute so much falls down, because there's more of them the further away you go. Obviously, you have to go through the math to be convinced of that. But it turns out so. So Edmund Halley's idea was wrong. Henrik Olbers himself, who it's named after, he said the reason that it gets dark at night is because although the universe could go on forever and distant stars contribute as much brightness as nearer stars, but there's intervening dust and gas in the universe that blocks the light from distant stars. And we know there is interstellar dust and gas. But the point is that given enough time, that dust and gas will heat up by absorbing the radiation of the light from the stars and galaxies that it's blocking, and eventually glow at the same temperature and therefore the same brightness as the objects it's obscuring. So it doesn't solve the problem. The problem was actually solved, and this is an absolutely delicious part of the story. It was solved not by an astronomer, not by a scientist, but by the writer Edgar Allan Poe. Now, Edgar Allan Poe fancied himself as a bit of an amateur scientist. And these days, we refer to him, my wife keeps telling me off, I refer to people like that as nutters. But she says, you can't say nutters, it's not nice. You know, maybe a bit deluded, but, you know, be nice. Well, he was one of those people who, you know, I've got a new theory of the universe, you know, and just before he died in his early 40s, he wrote in his, probably many people regard as his greatest work, Eureka, which was an essay based on lectures that he gave, in which he pontificated about the laws of physics and where Newton had got it wrong and things like that. And then amongst all that weird and wonderful stuff was this nugget of truth, the explanation for Olbers' paradox. The universe can be infinite in space. It can go on forever. The distant stars will contribute as much brightness as the nearer stars. The reason is the universe hasn't been around forever. It's finite in age. And we now know that's true. The universe had a beginning, the Big Bang, and it was proven later towards the end of the 19th century and early 20th century that is in fact true. We only see the light from the stars and galaxies that are close enough to us for their light to have reached us in the 13.7 billion years that the universe has been around. Now, the issue gets complicated because we now know the universe is expanding and it's stretching, getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And so the most distant stars and galaxies, their light is going to take longer and longer. It's like trying to go up an escalator that's coming down. And it gets harder and harder to reach us. But that just complicates the issue. The basic answer still stands. The reason it gets dark at night is because the universe had a beginning. And I love this because it's the sort of thing that a lot of people ask scientists, and they say, oh, you believe in the Big Bang, the universe started testing. How do you know? You weren't there. You know, how coming up with your theories. And there's lots of strong pieces of scientific evidence that confirm the Big Bang theory, as you know, we're pretty, you can never be certain in science, but we're pretty confident that's the correct explanation. Things like, you know, we see the universe expanding, and if it's getting bigger, then in the past it was smaller, and you go all the way, wind the clock all the way back, and everything was in one place. The fact that the Big Bang theory predicts that most of the universe will be hydrogen, 3/4 hydrogen, just under 1/4 helium, and then all the other elements of the periodic table make up 1 or 2%. The Big Bang predicts that the universe started 13.7 billion years ago, then it's been cooling down as it expands. And at the moment, it should have a certain temperature. And sure enough, you measure the temperature of deep space, and it's exactly what the theory predicts. So all those things contribute. But actually, you don't have to worry about that. People ask you, how do you know there was a Big Bang? You just say, well, go out at night outside. It gets dark. That's proof that the Big Bang happened. It's beautifully simple. The Big Bang happened, therefore it gets dark at night. Right, so that's an example of a mystery in science that spans centuries, that scientists keep coming at it from a different direction, proposing explanations for it, and until, you know, the time is right, we won't know the right answer. But of course, people like Edwin Hubble in the 1920s confirmed that the universe was indeed expanding, confirmed that stars are clumped together in galaxies and there are billions of galaxies out in space. And then we knew confidently that that idea was correct. I want to move on to sort of more always profound ideas. Because one of the other paradoxes I like is something called the paradox of Laplace's demon, which asks the question of whether the future is predictable, whether it is knowable. Is it all mapped out? Is it already out there waiting for us? Or is it open? The demon is meant to be this hypothetical, super intelligent being. Let's imagine it as a computer. A computer that's so powerful that it knows, it stores in its memory the position and state of motion of every particle, every atom in the universe. And at a given moment in time and how they're interacting. Now, if the universe is all sort of mechanistical, obeying the Newtonian laws of mechanics, then in principle, the computer can, if it knows the state of the universe now, it can crank a handle and calculate the state of the universe in the future. It can predict what the future will be like, including us and our thoughts and what we're going to do next. After all, we're just made of atoms and we're part of the universe. Then this computer will know what we're going to do next. The paradox is this. What if the programmer of the computer puts into it the following command? Calculate the state of the universe in 15 minutes' time. If in that universe you exist, then self-destruct now. If in that universe you don't exist because you've self-destructed, then do nothing. Immediately, you've got a real paradox, like that this statement is a lie paradox, because you know it can't. If it destroys itself, then it can. So it hasn't been able to predict a future by definition. And of course, there are other more sort of logical explanations that rule it out, that the computer is itself part of the universe, and in order to compute and know the state of all particles in the universe, it has to know the state of all the particles that it's made of itself. And how do you store that information? You have to store it on a physical substrate, you know, a system, whether it's logic circuits or whatever. Well, you have to know, you store within them their own state, and it's a rather self-referential paradox there that you can't really get around. But it's interesting because it leads to the idea of whether indeed the future is can be determined, and indeed whether we have free will. Because until the 20th century, scientists probably believed in this clockwork universe, the idea that if we knew in principle, even if in practice you could never have a computer or a being powerful enough to know everything, but in principle, all the particles in the universe obey the laws of physics, and so if you know the state at one point, then the laws of physics, the interactions of all the atoms bumping into each other and electromagnetic forces and so on, you should be able to compute what happens next. So everything is a machine, including us, including our minds and our thoughts and our consciousness. And provided you don't believe there's something magical, that consciousness is somehow the spirit that's separate from the physical, what's called the mind-body problem, then this is an issue. Therefore, we can't have free will. And many philosophers and scientists say that's exactly right. That is the state, that we don't have free will. We think we do. It's just an illusion. Well, it does lead on to this question, and this is an area of science that physicists, chemists, and biologists are starting to get very excited about, which is to what extent we can understand biology and life down at the level of the atoms and molecules that make it up. Neuroscience is one of the fastest growing areas of research today. But a lot of these ideas now seem to depend on the most powerful theory probably certainly in 20th century science, but I would say most powerful theory in the whole of science, which is quantum mechanics. I'm not doing this to advertise my book, because in any case, it's come out in paperback with a completely different cover, so you wouldn't see this in the shops anyway. But the reason, I wrote a book about quantum mechanics, and I say, it's a guide for the perplexed, but I guarantee that the reader is not going to be less perplexed after reading it. They'll only know why they are perplexed. And there's this lovely quote on the back from one of the founding fathers of quantum mechanics. If you're not astonished by quantum mechanics, then you haven't understood it. You're meant to be. Quantum mechanics is one of those few areas, probably Einstein's theory of relativity is the other one, areas of science where it really is counterintuitive. It really does mess with your head. And yet that seems to be how the world works. And physicists and chemists have had, coming up to a century now, of getting used to it. Because this is the theory that describes how atoms and the particles that make up atoms behave. So without quantum mechanics, we wouldn't know most of chemistry. We wouldn't understand the periodic table. We wouldn't understand how atoms fit together to make molecules. We wouldn't have modern electronics. We certainly wouldn't have been able to explain semiconductors. Therefore, we wouldn't have silicon chips, and we wouldn't have computers. We wouldn't have the laser. So much of modern technology we have because quantum mechanics describes the world of atoms. And yet, at its heart, it's very, very strange. I'm one of a small number of scientists who are now looking not at how quantum mechanics explains phenomena in physics and chemistry, but whether it plays a role in biology, in living organisms. We know that quantum mechanics has these weird features, but we know they're necessary to explain very fundamental phenomena in nature. So this is a picture of a star, our own star, the sun. And the reason the sun shines is because hydrogen atoms are fusing together to make helium, the several steps in the process, thermonuclear fusion. But it's not the whole atoms, it's the nuclei of hydrogen, protons, that are fusing together. But protons, if you remember your school physics, both have positive charge. And like charges repel. So why are these protons sticking together? It's like getting two north poles of magnets and trying to squash them together. Well, that's because if these protons get close enough together, another force takes over, the strong nuclear force, which is much more powerful and wins over the electrostatic repulsion of their positive charge. How do they get close enough together? Well, through a process called quantum tunneling. Quantum tunneling is one of those weird and wonderful features of the quantum world whereby a particle, imagine it's like a ball rolling up a hill. You've got to kick the ball hard enough to get to the top of the hill to roll down the other side. But if you only kick it halfway up, it's going to roll back down again every time. Not in the quantum world. In the quantum world, you can kick it an electron halfway up a metaphorical hill. It gets halfway up there and says, I wonder what it's like on the other side. Disappears and reappears on the other side. What a stupid theory. Who came up with that idea? And yet, that's what happens. Without quantum tunneling, the sun wouldn't shine. And there are other weird and wonderful ideas in quantum mechanics, something called superposition, whereby an atom or subatomic particle can do several things at once. This is an example that is familiar to me as a nuclear physicist. There's a particular nucleus, an isotope of lead, lead 186. You don't have to remember the number. Normally, we think of these atomic nuclei as having different shapes or vibrating or spinning. Well, here's an example of a nucleus that can be in three different shapes. It can be spherical, it can be prolate, so rugby ball shaped, or it can be oblate, like, you know, squashing a balloon. But it doesn't sort of, in real time, change shape from those three different configurations. It exists in all three shapes at the same time. When you look at it, it does something specific. You take a snapshot, it's only doing one or other of those three things. But when you turn away, it's doing all three. You say, well, how do you know it's doing all three? Well, that's the only way we can explain its properties. And there are many, many other examples in atomic, nuclear, and particle physics where you get things doing more than one thing at once. Atoms being in two places at once is the usual example people use. So quantum mechanics is very strange, and we've got used to it. We've got used to the strangeness in physics and chemistry. But in biology, it's still rather new. Basically started with one of the founding fathers of quantum mechanics, Ernest Schrödinger, who wrote a book called What is Life? I won't bother going through all of that, but basically he said that there's something special about life, and at its heart, it could be that quantum mechanics is playing a role. It was very influential. The book went on to influence people like Crick and Watson and their discovery of the structure of DNA. But the idea that quantum mechanics somehow plays a role in the messy, complicated environment of a living cell was deemed as a bit too wacky, too speculative, until about, well, within the last decade anyway, when suddenly biologists were coming up with experiments that seemed to suggest that, yes, indeed, that's what seems to be happening. Is life, therefore, quantum mechanical? There had been some earlier, much more speculative ideas. So Roger Penrose, who worked with Stephen Hawking, together with a colleague, Hameroff, speculated this back in the late 80s, early 90s, as to whether consciousness had a quantum origin. The premise being pretty much that consciousness is weird and we don't understand it, quantum mechanics is weird and we don't understand it. Wouldn't be great if the two were connected in some way. But they tried to come up with, down at the molecular level, an explanation for that. And it sort of went out of fashion. And people thought, you know, there's nothing much in it. You do see in popular science, people say, oh, we're quantum computers. You know, one day we'll build a quantum computer, a computer that can do all possible calculations at the same time. And maybe our brains are quantum computers because they use quantum mechanics. That's fallen out of favor. However, it is true that when you get down to the molecular level, well, at its heart, biology, molecular biology, is organic chemistry. And organic chemistry is built on the rules of quantum mechanics. So ultimately, quantum mechanics must play a role in the way the atoms and molecules fit together. But what we're looking at are other ideas, like whether quantum tunneling plays a role in living systems. And it turns out it probably does. Enzymes that help speed up certain chemical reactions in cells seem to be able to utilize some of the tricks of quantum mechanics, transporting electrons from one place to the other far quicker than they have any right to be, because they're disappearing from there and reappearing over there. And it looks like experiments are confirming this, that is really the way things work. I wanted to end then with my final paradox, which links back to this idea about whether quantum mechanics is important in life. It's a very simple one. Enrico Fermi was another one of the founders of quantum mechanics, and apparently he was sitting at a table with some other scientists in the 1950s talking about flying saucers, because it was all the rage back then, and said, yeah, but if they were flying saucers, where are they? How come we haven't been visited by aliens? How come it's only, you know, the farmer out in the Midwest has had, you know, one too many beers who sees the flying saucer? And then they started speculating about just what was so special about life. Has life really only occurred once? Has it only evolved and appeared here on Earth? What is it that's that magical step from inanimate organic matter to something that can replicate itself? Because once that happens, Darwinian evolution kicks in and complexity can build. Life has that special magical quality that it can maintain a state of what's called low entropy, a state of high order, and build up more and more complexity. But it's that first step, because it seems so unlikely that life could appear by accident, and yet here we are. And one of the ideas speculated upon is whether quantum mechanics again played a role in that initial spark for life. It's very speculative. You know, I've got a PhD student working on much more sort of grounded idea in quantum biology. He's basically looking at DNA mutations and whether you get a DNA mutation if a hydrogen atom in a hydrogen bond jumps from one strand of the DNA to the other, which we know can happen. Can that lead to a mutation? And he's doing sort of the calculation. So that's nice and safe. But there's all the way the spectrum in quantum biology goes all the way out to the wacky edges, like does quantum mechanics, is it required? Do you have to invoke quantum mechanics to explain the origin of life itself? To answer these questions, and we still don't know the answer, where how did life begin is one of the big mysteries remaining in science, but it's an area where physicists, chemists, and biologists, this is the shock of the new in science, are starting to work together. Rather than working in their own silos and not talking to each other, I'm realizing that, you know, I'm very ignorant about chemistry, and I shouldn't be, and biology is a darn sight more difficult and messy and complicated than I actually realized. But it's only when you bring these three areas, three disciplines together, that we're going to answer these sorts of questions. And that's what makes that search, looking for these deep questions, very satisfying. You can't maintain working in one narrow area without sticking your head up above the parapet and looking around and seeing what other scientists are doing. And on that point, I think I should stop. Thank you very much for your attention. I am happy to take a few questions if we have time.
Hi, Jim. The LHC gives us a picture a fraction of a second after the Big Bang.
Yes.
Do you think in your lifetime we'll find out exactly what happened at the time of the Big Bang?
Well, the moment, the point of the Big Bang is one of those areas where it's the best way I can explain it is like dividing by zero on your calculator. Things blow up, you get error. But at that particular precise point, energy becomes, you know, energy, the density, you know, the universe is down to a point and everything goes to infinity. What we are starting to think about is whether the Big Bang wasn't the beginning of time itself, whether there was something before the Big Bang. So we may not be able to explain the Big Bang precisely, but we might be able to say that it grew out of, you know, whether our universe is maybe not the only one. Our universe is a bubble within a higher dimensional multiverse. So until about 10, 20 years ago, that wasn't the sort of question that was being asked. But cosmologists are now pushing not just to the Big Bang, but to try and describe the universe before.
Hello?
Hello.
Sorry, hi.
Ah, hi.
Hi, sorry. Where's the missing dollar?
Ah, good, thank you. Yes, I was worried. How many people had heard that one before? How many people hadn't but figured it out? And how many people are still puzzled? Good. Okay, well, the answer is in the telling. I said, they each paid $27, plus the two in his pocket makes 29, where's the missing one? What I should have said, they each paid $27, take away the two, which he put in his pocket, leaving 25 in the till. There's no longer $30 that you have to account for. The room cost 25. They paid $2 more than they should have done, which he kept. So it's that I said 27 plus the two. I should have said take away the two. See how easy? That sounds like a clap of relief.
Dare I ask if you think there are any implications from quantum mechanics for consumer behavior or social behavior, which is the kind of stuff that we do?
I don't think so. I mean, I think we get a lot of people saying, quantum entanglement, two particles very far apart that are somehow, their fates are intertwined, they're still interconnected. That must explain telepathy. Or that must explain twins, how they know, they sense each other. The thing about quantum mechanics is that all that weird stuff in quantum mechanics is constrained down at the quantum world, at level of atoms. Once it gets more and more complicated, the weirdness leaks away, like heat dissipating, which is why it's so surprising that we see quantum behavior in biology, because we can't imagine it could be maintained, atoms being in two places at once inside the cell. It seems to be able to do that. But once you get out to our macro everyday world, then all that weirdness is no longer there. So I can't see how it might apply more broadly.
Hi. My question is about the woman with a high IQ.
Yes.
What was her response? I don't think we got the answer.
Oh, well, no, her response her initial response was, you should always change to C because such and such. So she gave the correct explanation. It's just that a lot of the people who wrote in said, even after she'd explained it, because she didn't obviously explain it as clearly as I did. That's a problem, you know. So they clearly weren't convinced. But no, she gave the right answer.
Ever since Popper, instead of trying to prove things, we've tried to say things have to be refutable. Can you prove it's not true? We're now seeing things like multiverse. Do you think science is taking a bit of a blind route and it's throwing up all sorts of things which are not refutable?
Only in those certain areas. I mean, there are people who work in cosmology and multiverse, or the guys who work in string theory. They're coming up with hypotheses and theories that are not yet testable. But for the majority of scientists, science is about, you know, your theory only survives for as long as it continues to predict empirical data and matches the real world. So unless you can empirically test the theory, it's not really a scientific theory. And so a lot of scientists are saying things like multiverse ideas and string theory aren't yet proper scientific theories because we've got no way to test them. So I think most scientists would agree that, theories are there to be knocked down and refuted. The onus is on, on them to find the evidence to prove the theory. The onus isn't on us. When I say there are fairies at the bottom of my garden, you say, well, go and give me the evidence. I don't say to you, give me the evidence that I'm wrong.
Hiya. Just a quick one on the game show paradox.
Where are we?
Sorry. What happens if the people on A just happen to make the same decision at the second point in time?
I don't...
The people who chose door A before the goat is revealed...
Yes.
If they're given the choice again to stick or twist... What about if they just happen to make the same decision second time round?
Well, they can do it. Statistics. I mean, every time you play the game, randomly, the car is placed behind one of the doors. So there's a 1 in 3 chance that it'll have been behind A in the first time they play it. And if they stick, they'll have got it. But the second time, there's still only a 1 in 3 chance it's behind A. It could be somewhere else.
I apologize to everyone in the room because I'm a quali, but... Don't the probabilities equalize if you make the same decision by chance?
No, statistically...
Right. The quali will shut up now.
The 1 in 3 chance, I mean, you can... I suggest you do it with 3 cards. You know, if you keep sticking, you make your first choice, and every time you stick and you don't change, whether the choice is A, B, or C, then after 100 times, 33 or thereabouts of the times, you will have been right to stick. But 2/3 of the time, you'll have been wrong and therefore should have switched. And there's only one choice to switch to. It's the other one that's still covered.
You and other theoretical physicists seem to be quite comfortable with the idea of uncertainty. Most people are entirely the opposite. So have you got any tips?
Well, it depends what you mean by uncertainty. I mean, there's the quantum physicist uncertainty, which is that it's uncertainty that is embedded in the very structure of the universe, and there's nothing we can do about it. You know, there's an uncertainty in the position of an atom, for instance, and it's not because I'm clumsy in trying to locate where it is or because I have bad instruments. It's nothing to do with my experiment. It really is inherent there. Uncertainty in areas outside of quantum mechanics, other areas of science, well, I mean, it's a vital part of science that, you know, that you can never be 100% sure about something. You always have to build in the error bars, and that's something that's trained in, drummed into scientists from the very earliest parts of their training.
So would you give a warm thank you?